You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, my name is Dr. Teodros Avery. I'm the professor of jazz studies here at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. This is the seventh session of the class entitled Key Movements, The Age of Jazz. I'd like to start this out by reading a few words from a gentleman by the name of Yehuda Berg. This is what he says about the usage of words that we use every day. He says, words are singularly the most powerful force available to humanity. We can choose to use this force constructively with words of encouragement or destructively using words of despair. Words have energy and power with the ability to help, to heal, to hinder, to hurt, to harm, to humiliate, and to humble. So that just gives you an idea of the power of what we're going to be talking about today. We'll be talking about great poets of the Harlem Renaissance, such as Langston Hughes, Claude McKay, Countee Cullen, and James Weldon Johnson. And these people are the leaders of the school of poets that moved to New York City during the age of jazz. There were others, but these were probably the most prominent ones that people look back at through the eyes of history to determine who was the most effective during that time. So we're going to start out with Langston Hughes. You see his picture right here. Langston Hughes was born on February 1st, 1902 in Joplin, Missouri. He was raised in Illinois, Ohio, and Mexico. Finally, he traveled to New York City, where he attended Columbia University. It was in New York City that Hughes witnessed the cultural revolution that was happening in the Harlem Renaissance. When his first book was published, he had already been a truck farmer, a cook, a waiter, a college graduate, a sailor, and a doorman at a nightclub in France. He was also a very, very worldly man, having traveled to West Africa, to the Azores in Portugal, the Canary Islands, Holland, France, and Italy. These travels shaped Hughes' poetry style and his outlook on humanity. He knew what it was like to be common folk, and his poetry spoke to common black folk. So this to kind of give you an idea that this is a man who was on the heartbeat of the people, and he felt like he wanted to write about and to those people, that he was not writing poetry for the elite or even for academia. He wanted to make sure his poetry spoke directly to common people who were working regular jobs every day, who were on the bus, who were on the train, who were, you know, getting up early in the morning to go clearly across town to work. He knew what that was like. And so his poetry reflected those feelings, those moods, and those perspectives. And as you'll see later, there are some who we will talk about who do not come from that perspective at all. But he did. Now, he was applauded by black people, by the people that he actually was speaking to during the Harlem Renaissance. But he wasn't highly regarded among critics. They wanted a more fiery and expressive poet than what Hughes offered. They wanted, usually as they do, they want something that goes against the grain of what people are hearing and seeing. But he was different from that. He understood that he wanted to be able to connect with people on a large, a mass level, and that he could affect change through those relationships that he spoke about to those people. It's two different types of thinking. You have some people who are critically acclaimed, but yet people may not know who they are. The public may not know. The public generally is not critically, they're not of the mindset of a critic. They're not thinking about the trajectory of that discipline, right? So like, you know, a common person would hear a poet and they'd say, oh, I like that poem. A critic might hear it and say, well, he's got a little bit of Walt Whitman, he's got a little bit of this person, a little bit of Maya Angelou, but what he does is he falls short of this type of thinking that those people exuded, and so therefore he's not really that good. Where a common person would just say, I like the poem and I want to hear it. So he was one of those people that was trying to connect to the latter, the person who just wanted to hear a poem, wanted to hear words that spoke directly to him. And he did so. The black critics felt he aired out black problems to the world in that it was bad enough that white critics did the same. So they, a lot of their feelings were, hey man, why are you telling everybody our business? You know, things that we're not too proud about. Why are you telling everyone that? You know, and his position was, hey, I'm trying to relate to people who are going through that every day. I'm directing this at them. But the certain faction of black critics, they were like, look, you don't need to talk about that. You know, you don't need to talk about what it feels like to be, you know, this or that or whatever the case may be. We want you maybe to talk about, you know, this more fiery type of message, you know, really say something to really scratch the ears of people, you know, common folk and also the public. Do that instead. But he's like, no, I just want to talk directly to the people and let them be positively affected by my poems. So that was a different approach. Aside from black critics, Hughes made giant achievements, the first being that he was able to sustain his life as an artist exclusively from poetry. Now, that's a good point, because a lot of the poets that we're looking at, I mean, we're looking back in time, and it appears if you don't know who these people are, you would think that that's all they did, right? If you see someone in a suit and a tie, and you see them in front of a podium, you think, oh, you know, he must be working all the time, doing public speaking engagements and making great money. But that's not necessarily so. A lot of these poets, I mean, they dressed up when they, you know, when they would perform, but a lot of them were working regular jobs, some as editors, some at newspapers, things like that. I know poets today, making your living as a poet exclusively is extremely hard. Because people, you know, they don't have an acquired taste immediately for a poem, right? You have an acquired taste for a cup of coffee, right, every day, or a cup of tea, but not necessarily for a poem. So that affects poets and how many books they sell, how many poems they publish, etc. But Langston Hughes was able to live off of his words that he wrote. So he was the first of his type during this time, and might have been the only one to be exclusively a poet. That's something to take note of. And if you can imagine during those times when there were people who were qualified to do different things, but they were not able to do them because of the color of their skin, that even makes his accomplishment of being someone who was able to make money off of his words
as being just a great, great, great achievement, you know.
As I spoke of a few weeks ago, talking about one of the band leaders, Fletcher Henderson, he was someone who had studied science and he got a degree in science, but then when he tried to get a job in pharmaceuticals, he couldn't get one. He was qualified, but he couldn't get one. So this man right here was able to write poetry exclusively, sell the poems, sell his books, his anthologies,
and make a really good living. So that's something to check out.
Let's watch this short biography on Langston Hughes. You're going to hear a lot of words from people who studied him and who knew his work. And one thing you'll be able to see is that he is buried in New York City at the Schoenberg Center for Research in Black Culture. So that's something to check out. They have a lot of his works there. It's for those of you who don't know what the Schoenberg is, it's basically a research library in Harlem, not far from the area where the areas where he walked around and you know, lived his life. And they have been one of the premier institutions in New York that took all of his poems and everything that was important to him, and they have housed it there at the Schoenberg. So if you get a chance, you go to New York City, stop by the Schoenberg and check out Langston Hughes' collection there. Okay, here we go. This is the biography on Langston Hughes.
Author, because he spoke to, for, and about black people in America.
Poet, novelist, and playwright, Langston Hughes was the leading voice of the Harlem Renaissance.
America was changing during the time that Langston Hughes was so popular. Black consciousness was becoming more and more public, more prominent. I think that Langston Hughes was important because he was one of the early figures to show the dignity and the beauty of ordinary black life.
He was one of the most visible of the younger black poets, a new generation that described themselves as the new Negro. They covered new topics, took on new poetic forms, and sought a wider audience, and Langston Hughes was at the forefront of that.
James Mercer Langston Hughes was born in Joplin, Missouri on February 1st, 1902.
He wrote a lot about being lonely when he was young, and I think that was a tremendous part of the product of moving around so much.
After graduating high school, Hughes published his first and most famous poem, The Negro Speaks of Rivers.
It is the first poem that celebrates Africa and dignifies the image of Africa in American literature.
The Negro Speaks of Rivers was published in a popular black journal, and so he was really rather widely read from the beginning. His poetry and his prose actually had access to everyday people.
While studying at Columbia University, Hughes discovered the Harlem art scene, spending hours in jazz and blues clubs, weaving the rhythms of music into his work.
Jazz and blues were great influences on Langston Hughes. He sought to capture the energy and vitality of the music in his poetry.
He was very familiar with the Harlem nightlife. He knew the musicians, and later in his life, he would even collaborate with some of the key figures at that time, such as Duke Ellington.
Hughes was a prolific writer and one of the first African-American authors who could support himself through his writing.
Langston Hughes wrote plays. He edited anthologies of poets of African descent across the diaspora. He wrote short stories. One of his most famous series of short stories centers around Jesse B. Simple. These are tales told by a resident of Harlem to an aspiring writer who's a stand-in for Langston Hughes.
He was one of the more widely published of the young poets of the period. He was also among the better connected. He really worked hard to promote the careers of other young writers in Harlem and also throughout the rest of his life. That's also one of his big legacies.
Langston Hughes died of cancer on May 22, 1967. His Harlem residence was given landmark status, a fitting tribute for a legendary writer.
His influence, his ambition as a creative writer, his success, his accessibility. He wrote for the average person. He was not writing for college classrooms. He was not writing for the elite. All of those things, I think, require that we recognize and acknowledge him as a great American literary voice.
All right. So that was Langston Hughes. You get to see the different professionals and academics speaking about him. What's interesting is that there are academics speaking about Langston, but Langston was more connected to the people than to academia. So there's an argument right there, you know, can someone speak directly to the people and still be studied later as a serious artist? And here we can say yes, someone can do that. So I found that to be interesting.
What I try to do whenever I talk about any of the artists here in the class is that when that artist has material that I can find where they're either speaking or talking about their paintings or doing whatever,
I like to let them speak for themselves.
So I am now going to let you hear Langston Hughes read his poem, The Negro Speaks of Rivers.
So we're going to let you hear it from Langston Hughes himself. No one can read Langston Hughes better than Langston Hughes. So here we go. The Negro Speaks of Rivers.
This is The Negro Speaks of Rivers, one of my earliest poems written in 1920, just after I came out of high school. The way this poem came to be written was that I was going to Mexico to visit my father, who lived in Mexico City. And on the train going across the Mississippi River, just outside St. Louis, I looked out the window and I saw this great muddy river flowing down toward the heart of the South. And I began to think about what this river meant to the Negro people, how, in a sense, our history was linked to this river, how in slavery time, my grandmother told me that to be sold down the Mississippi was one of the worst things that could happen to a Negro slave. And then I remembered that I'd read about Abraham Lincoln going down the Mississippi as a young man. He went on a raft to New Orleans, and he saw human beings bought and sold in the slave market there. And he was so horrified by this that he never forgot it. And many years later, of course, we know that it was Lincoln who signed the Emancipation Proclamation. And so, as the train went on into the gathering dusk, because it had been about sunset when we crossed the river, I took my father's letter out of my pocket and began to write down on the back of his letter this poem, "The Negro Speaks of Rivers." I've known rivers. I've known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood in human veins. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. I bathed in the Euphrates when dawns were young. I built my hut near the Congo, and it lulled me to sleep. I looked upon the Nile and raised the pyramids above it. I heard the singing of the Mississippi when Abe Lincoln went down to New Orleans, and I have seen its muddy bosom turn all golden in the sunset. I've known rivers, ancient, dusky rivers. My soul has grown deep like the rivers.
All right, Langston Hughes. Yeah, it's good to hear an artist speak for themselves, right? Because you can't miss it. You can't miss what they meant when they spoke or when they recited their poetry in this situation. A lot of times we get a little carried away with different angles of analysis. And sometimes you can just listen to the artist speak and it just kind of brings everything into focus really well. As you can hear when he spoke, he chose a topic like rivers. Everyone understands what a river is. And he used that as a metaphor for the long withstanding culture, the generations of culture that he comes from. And so he mentioned different rivers around the world to say that he's more than just one area, you know, of thinking. And this was a man who had traveled all around the world at a very young age. So he had that perspective, that universal perspective, a very international perspective. And then when he spoke, he wasn't trying to confuse you. He was speaking very straightforward in a very easy to understand type of way. So that had a lot to do with the way his poetry was able to reach so many people, you know, and this exists also in music and film and any discipline. If you go too far with the technical side, that, you know, that the people who are practitioners in that area that they talk about and pontificate, if you go too far in that area, that you can actually not communicate with the people. But if you stay on the pulse of the people and you know what the people are concerned and then you know how far they can go and how far they cannot go, then you can reach the people. And he did that very well as an artist. With that template, he went to jazz music. And he was spending time in all the clubs, as you saw in the biography video. And so he's hearing all the leading jazz players in Harlem and also in Manhattan, downtown Manhattan, all these different people. And you have to understand that at the time, New York was the center of the modern jazz world. So whatever was happening right in the moment, the new thing, it was happening in New York during that time. Of course, you still had Chicago and you still had Kansas and you had New Orleans. They were still big jazz cities, but the more newer approach that was centered around the industrial city of New York and it being a center of commerce and everything and, you know, attracting people from all over the world, New York had the most cutting edge sound. And so Langston Hughes was listening to the most cutting edge sound at night. So he couldn't help but be influenced by that type of sound of jazz. So the pacing of jazz. You know, with, you have some performers in jazz who take their time. They don't rush through the music, and they might just take their time. Somebody like Billie Holiday, she would take her time. She wouldn't be in a rush to sing a song. She'd slow a song down, sing the lyrics in a very direct, but in a way that lets you know that she has wisdom. He was in that area of thinking and expression. It wasn't the real fast da 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 da. I was walking up seven at seven. I walked up to the street. It wasn't that kind of poetry. It was more slowed down, direct. He took his time and he paced himself. Now, to my knowledge, he is the first person to mix jazz with poetry, and that was ahead of its time. You know, most poets would listen to the music or any other style of music, but they wouldn't bring that music along to their poetry. So he was the first one to do that. And then that in itself spawned a whole generation of poets who used jazz with music. You have people like Amiri Baraka, he used jazz with music. You have the beat poets, they used jazz with music in San Francisco and in different places like that. So that was a whole new sound that he started, right? So he was definitely a cutting edge poet as well as just a regular poet, but he was cutting edge. Let me use music, let me use jazz, let me use this music that people are coming up to Harlem and they're dancing and they're, you know, having a great time, and Duke Ellington's writing all these arrangements, and I'm hearing, you know, I'm going to the Cotton Club and I'm hearing all this music, and let me maybe write some words or something similar to that. And that was different. That was ahead of its time. That was innovative thinking as an artist, but also as a poet. Now we're going to listen to Langston Hughes perform with a band called the Doug Parker Jazz Band. This is from 1958, and this is a poem that he wrote called Weary Blues. Weary Blues.
Good evening. Tonight, Mr. Langston Hughes, American poet, dramatist, novelist, lyricist, lecturer. He's in town to give a lecture at UBC, but he's here tonight to read poetry, his own poetry, to a jazz accompaniment. We have Alan Miller to interview him. We have Doug Parker and his band to provide the jazz. And Mr. Langston Hughes has his own accompaniment, his own introduction. Suns are setting. This is what I'm gonna sing. Suns are setting. This is what I'm gonna sing. I feel the blues are coming. I wonder what the blues will bring. Drowsy, syncopated tune, rocking back and forth to a mellow croon. I heard a Negro play. Down on Lenox Avenue the other night, by the pale, dull pallor of a one bulb light, he did a lazy sway. He did a lazy sway to the tune of those weary blues. With his ebony hands on each ivory key, he made that poor piano moan with melody. Oh, blues.
swaying to and fro on his rickety stool, he played that sad, raggy tune like a musical fool. Sweet blues, coming from a black man's soul. Old blues. In a deep song voice with a melancholy tone, I heard that Negro sing, that old piano moan. Ain't got nobody in all this world, ain't got nobody but myself. I'm going to quit my frowning and put my troubles on the shelf. Thump, 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 when he's put on the floor. He played a few chords, then he sang some more. I got the weary blues, I can't be satisfied. Got the weary blues, I can't be satisfied. I ain't happy no more, and I wish that I had died. Far into the night, he crooned that tune. The stars went out, and so did the moon. The singer stopped playing and went to bed, while the weary blues echoed through his head. He slept like a rock, or a man that's dead.
All right. So he's performing with the Doug Parker Jazz Band. Doug Parker was a musician in Canada. And actually that network, CBUT, is a Canadian network as well. So he was a Canadian jazz musician. And that was his group backing up Langston Hughes. Now, I want to maybe help you hear some things that show that Langston Hughes was influenced by jazz. Did you get to hear how in the beginning when he said, the blues, when he said blues, that was jazz.
Coming through the music. Blues, kind of like a fall off.
The blues, right? Most people during that time when they said words, they just said the blues, right? Just a straight approach. He heard jazz in the words, and you can hear it when he spoke the words. So that's one thing you want to check out, is that the music was influencing how he spoke English. And then he also made sure that he spoke like black Americans at the time in Harlem. You know, of course not, he was not trying to speak like a black lawyer, but he was trying to speak like entertainers speak that had just migrated from the South. And when he said, ain't got, that ain't got no, you know, that's how they spoke. So he was one of the poets that put that into his poetry. Though he was educated at Columbia University, he knew that was
grammatically incorrect by the rules, but that didn't, if he didn't do that, it wouldn't capture the feeling that he felt when he was in Harlem. So he would break the rules to tell the story and to relate to the people. And, you know, it's very important when you're trying to relate a culture to a group of people or to a group of people that are from the culture or also, well, especially the people who are from the culture. If you want to relate to them, you have to speak their language, right? You can't say, okay, well, this is not grammatically correct, so I'm not going to read it like that. He would have never been able to connect with the people, with the black people of his time. Because he wanted to speak a colloquial language, right? So that was something you should note as well, that he broke the rules to cut through and to relate to the people using his own words and also using the influence of jazz. Also, I hope you saw that he would pace himself, that he would speak and then pause and let the music be a part of the performance. So he would read a line, and then just stop. And then you hear the melody. So what he was doing was that he was taking these two worlds and he was making them one. Really making sure that the music was heard and that the words were heard. One common mistake that a lot of poets, I've worked with a lot of poets, so I know how to play with a poet and I know how to arrange music for a poet. And one mistake that often happens is that
the musicians are just playing and playing, and then the audience can't hear the words of the poet. So a lot of musicians, they don't always have the sensitivities to play with a poet because they gotta know when to pull back, when to not play
an instrument that's right in the same sound or frequency as the human voice that's reciting the poetry. So that's important as well.
So what he did in that performance was he would speak, then he'd stop.
And then he'd let the music play. And then he would come back in and he would speak. And that way you could hear exactly what he was saying, but he let you know that the performance of the jazz group was equally important to him.
So that's advanced arranging in music. That's very advanced arranging. Don't think that because he was not using a lot of words that he wasn't brilliant and that he wasn't putting it all together in a very, very intelligent way that was purposely done. It was totally done a certain way on purpose, and no one was doing poetry like that at the time. Now we're going to listen to him recite one of his poems called Dream Deferred. And what you're going to hear here is a totally different approach than what you heard just a moment ago with the Weary Blues. And this poem is really straightforward. It's not a musical poem. So you can just listen to his words and hear his message. Dream Deferred by Langston Hughes.
What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or crust and sugar over like a syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load, or does it explode? What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or crust and sugar over like a syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load, or does it explode?
Now, when I listened to that poem, I definitely saw a certain way that he was trying to express the content. Notice at the last line he says, or does it explode? Like he's really making you listen to what he's saying. And then you have to use your imagination to what he's talking about when he says, or does it explode? To me, what he's saying is that people can have their dreams, and they can either make their dreams happen or their dreams cannot happen, either because they are the orchestrators of that or if someone else is the orchestrator of that, stopping a person's dream from happening. So that, to me, that was a very poignant poem, totally different from the Weary Blues. The Weary Blues is like a, you know, you feel like you're in a jazz club and everybody's kind of, you know, sipping on something and feeling good. You know, you can see it might be a Friday night or something, you know. With Dream Deferred, it's like none of that. It's really digging at you about people in their dreams and also people who do not want to see those dreams happen. Very, very powerful poem. Okay, next we're going to talk about Claude McKay. There's Claude right there. Claude McKay was born on September 15th, 1889, in Clarendon Parish, Jamaica. He was a poet and an activist. He was an important figure in the Harlem Renaissance movement, and he's also known for his social activism as a part of Marcus Garvey's UNIA, or Universal Negro Improvement Association. Claude McKay was one of the most blunt of the Harlem Renaissance poets. We have to realize that racism that he experienced as a dark-skinned Jamaican immigrant must have been paramount at the very least. and because, you know, he was new to America. So, you know, it was a different time during those times, especially if you were not from America. And because of this, there was not one bit of apprehension in his message whatsoever. Okay, so now we have Claude McKay. His approach is totally different from Langston Hughes. I mean, Claude is he's, you know, part of Marcus Garvey's UNIA. These were real activists who were willing to do whatever they had to do to gain freedom. So their approach was just not like, or his approach was just not like Langston Hughes. He was more of a, you could say, a revolutionary. That was his approach. He really was not afraid to write poetry that challenged the status quo. He was a person who pretty much felt like if he didn't say something, that he probably would not affect change. And right now I'm going to read a poem by him. It's called If We Must Die. I read it a few weeks ago here during the class, but I'll read it again. And when I read this poem, you have to understand that this is, and you'll hear it in the words, but this is somebody who's been watching lynchings, who's been watching black people get killed. He's been watching severe poverty. He's been watching severe racism. And he's also been experiencing it. So his approach is, I'm going to talk right to the people who are committing these acts against my people. And so he has a totally different approach, and you're going to hear it right now. So this is called If We Must Die. If we must die, let it not be like hogs, hunted and penned in an inglorious spot, while round us bark the mad and hungry dogs, making their mock at our cursed lot. If we must die, oh, let us nobly die, so that our precious blood may not be shed. In vain, then even the monsters we defy shall be constrained to honor us, though dead. O kinsmen, we must meet the common foe. Though far outnumbered, let us show us brave, and for the thousand blows deal one death blow. What though before us lies the open grave? Like men, we'll face the murderous, cowardly pack, pressed to the wall, dying, but fighting back. So that's a pretty powerful poem. I mean, he's basically saying, if we're going to die, let's just fight. Let's fight it out. Let's not just die like cowards. Let's die with our dignity. Now, in the past, when I mentioned the Red Summer, you can tell that when I was talking about the different groups that were, the different groups of black people who were in fights with, you know, groups of whites, large, you know, cops and things like that. Well, mainly with the groups, not with the cops, but with the groups of people, some of them were starting to fight back. This is part of like being the new Negro, that they weren't just gonna sit and just take a licking or take a whooping. That some of these people were fighting against racism. So if they were being shot at, they would shoot back.
If they were being beat up, they would hit back.
So Claude McKay is a part of that,
that he's saying, we're gonna fight back. We're not just gonna lay down and just be dog food, you know. He's a part of that. And that's coming from Marcus Garvey, that they were willing to do whatever they had to get freedom. With Langston Hughes, he was more of a statesman. He was not somebody who would be affiliated with Marcus Garvey's movement. And so this is where the rub is with the critics, because the critics felt like Langston
didn't embody a lot of the message that someone like Claude McKay embodied. And you can see Claude McKay was speaking right to severe racial problems in America, and that he wasn't afraid to do it. But Langston wasn't a part of that, you know. Langston went to Columbia University, you know. And it's kind of interesting. He didn't want to be associated with, he didn't want his poetry associated with the elite, but Columbia University is an elite institution. So he was a part of that in terms of how he did not say things, if that makes sense to you. Where Claude McKay, he was not a part of an institution like Columbia University. He did attend colleges. He attended Morehouse University down south for a short time, and then he transferred to another institution. But he, if anything, he was more a part of Marcus Garvey's university, if you know what I mean. That's where he was coming from.
And that's what he was dedicated to, that ideology. He was a part of the UNIA, so he was approaching life from that perspective. So it's important that you know the difference between these two gentlemen and the others as well, but know that there was a different approach with Claude McKay. Totally different, did not really care to make everybody happy with his poetry. That he was really trying to free his people as much as he could with his poems. Here's another poem that he wrote, and it's another poem that's straightforward, and it contrasts Langston Hughes' style. This is called To the White Fiends. Think you I am not fiend and savage too? Think you I could not arm me with a gun and shoot down 10 of you for every one of my black brothers murdered, burnt by you? Be not deceived, for every deed you do, I could match, outmatch, am I not Africa's son? Black of the black land where black deeds are done? But the Almighty from the darkness drew my soul and said, even now shall be a light, a while to burn on the benighted earth. Thy dusky face I set among the white for thee to prove thyself of highest worth, before the world is swallowed up in night, to show thy little lamp, go forth, go forth. So in this poem, he's basically talking about black people being murdered, black men specifically, and he's saying, I can be just as ruthless as my enemy. He's saying, I'll do whatever I have to do to defend myself. And he's saying he could outdo his enemy. Within that, he's saying, but the Almighty from the darkness drew my soul and said, even though thou shalt be a light. So that's God speaking to him and saying that he can still be a light. So this is totally different from Langston Hughes. But it's important for you to know because he's one of the leaders of the Harlem Renaissance. So I'll give you a 4-second break because I know some of these poems are pretty intense. But it is what it is. This is what it is. This is history, and we should all learn from it. Now we're going to go on to a poet by the name of Countee Cullen. Countee Cullen. There he is right there. Countee Cullen was born on May 30th, 1903. His grandmother brought him to Harlem when he was 9 years old. By the time he reached high school, Countee excelled at his studies, graduating with honors in Latin, Greek, mathematics, and French. He won many different poetry contests in New York City throughout high school and college, where he received his bachelor's degree from NYU and his master's degree from Harvard University. His two most popular poems are Heritage in black Christ.
Heritage is a poem about black Americans and their relationship with Africa when black Americans were waking up to their Africanness. So this is a time when you got to imagine that we're talking about the 1920s that the Harlem Renaissance happened in. Some of these people, they knew people who were enslaved. 1865 was the Emancipation Proclamation was signed. So that's not a lot of time. 35 years plus 20, 55 years. So you have to know that the mindset of most black people during this time was that of somebody who either was living under and obeying Jim Crow laws, which were extensions of slavery, or they were still thinking like a slave. No independence in terms of how they thought, how they lived their lives. They pretty much did what they were told. The new Negro, of which these poets are a part of, they represent a deviation away from that type of thinking. These are people who saw themselves as being equal, but had the intelligence to also navigate through society and also to construct their lives. So their poems reflected that. And now what's important, it's hard for people to understand how much of these people were trendsetters during their time. You see, for someone to write a poem or in this day write a rap that has this kind of content is very commonplace. During that time, nobody really said things like this. These people were really going against the grain. So it's important for you to know that. These people were saying things that had never been said before for black people. And not only that, they were really putting their lives on the line daily by writing and saying these things. Daily, putting their lives right on the line. But because they were educated and they saw a future for themselves and for their families, it was worth it to them. So you want to really check that out because that's going to give you a perspective about who these people were and how they were putting it on the line and didn't care because they knew what the other side was like. They knew what it was like to see people hang from trees. They knew what it was like to see women get raped. They knew what it was like to see little boys get hung. They knew what that was like. So they were on a race in the opposite direction. And so you have to remember what we've talked about up to this point with the lynchings, the racial fighting and all that to really understand these poets and where they were coming from and why they were so effective during their generation. And even now, but people, you know, you want to talk about, you know, how today, you know, someone will say, oh, well, you know, so-and-so is, you know, he's writing these lyrics and he's, man, he's really saying something. He might be saying something or she might be saying something, but the context is different. See, without these poems and these poets, what we're hearing today would really be something. But these poets, they really laid down the groundwork for what we're seeing today. And this is good for the people who listen to hip hop, if people were making beats back then, like they do now, you would really get the full effect of these poets.
You know, but because they were just speaking words, you probably don't get it as much. But go through the content, really look at what they're saying, and read through the words to really suss out what they mean with the metaphors, and you will see that these are very innovative thinkers, way ahead of their time, and that what we're seeing now today in music and how, you know, now people are putting music, or rather words with music through rap, that, yeah, there's some great things happening now, But you need to know that these people were doing that type of, those types of expressions with music and without music, but in the 1920s, when if you said what you said, you might lose your life.
Now I'm going to read a poem by Countee Cullen. This is called Heritage.
We can get that on the big screen. You get to see what they're talking about. You see the statues, the African statues. So you can understand what he's talking about.
He says, "What is Africa to me? Copper sun or scarlet sea? Jungle star or jungle track? Strong bronzed men or regal black? Women from those loins I sprang when the birds of Eden sang. 1-3 centuries removed from the scenes his fathers loved. Spicy grove, cinnamon tree, what is Africa to me? So I lie, who all day long want no sound except the song sung by wild barbaric birds, goading massive jungle herds, juggernauts of flesh that pass, trampling tall, defiant grass, where young forest lovers lie, plighting troth beneath the sky. So I lie, who always hear? Though I cram against my ear, both my thumbs and keep them there, great drums throbbing through the air. So I lie, whose fount of pride, dear distress, and joy allied."
So that's Heritage. And, you know, during this time, with the help of people like Marcus Garvey, they're really looking to Africa as being their home, or their old home, and America being their new home. This is moving away from a certain mentality in black people, which is that they don't know anything about their heritage. They don't know Africa. They don't know that they're connected to Africa, and they don't care. This is a different group of people. They're saying, yeah, I'm from Africa. I live in America, but I'm from Africa. My grandparents are from Africa. My great-grandparents are from Africa. I'm aware of the lineage, the culture that Africa represents to me and to the world. They're totally aware of that, these poets, and they are proud of it. They're very proud of it. And now we're going to move on to the cover of The Black Christ. The cover for the book. There it is right there. And then we're going to move on to the actual poem. Actually, this is kind of interesting. On this cover, you see that there are objects that are both black and white, and very strong-looking objects. You don't see, what's important to note is that you don't see the stereotypical black images. You know, the Sambo type images. The big, you know, eyes, you know, looking fearful. The big red lips. You don't see any of that. They were moving away from those stereotypes. And those are stereotypes that they saw every day in newspapers, on the containers for different household products. Those images were very, very commonplace in American society. Here you have images that are opposite of that, that are enlightened, and in this case, even angelic. And if you look at the faces, you don't see the red lips, the big eyes, the buffoonery that was often commonplace with images of this time. They were moving away from that. They didn't want to be a part of it. These were intelligent, conscious people that were really trying to write history for their people.
Now, with this poem, The Black Christ, Cullen draws parallels between the suffering of the crucified Christ and the suffering of African Americans in the climate of racial violence that characterized the 1920s. So these, like I said, these people were seeing a lot of violence
committed against black people, and
I think a lot of them realized that they could take a number of different approaches. They could be angry, or they could use their faith as a way to get them through it.
And also see parallels, as he did, with the suffering of Christ. And use the suffering of black people as a way to get through what they were seeing on a regular basis, you know, whether it was on a newspaper or was something that they heard about from their relatives, or in some cases, with some of these people being from the South, things that they had seen themselves. They really, really knew what it was like to live in the Jim Crow South, and they didn't like it.
And you have to understand that a lot of these people, like as in the case of Countee Cullen, here's somebody who went to school at NYU and also at Harvard University. You know, it's really a hard sell to someone who's educated like that to make them believe that they can live a life beyond Jim Crow. It's just a hard sell. These people were educated, and they were artists, and they were expressive artists. So there really was no way but out for them, and they really wanted to inspire their people behind them. So now I'm going to read the poem, The Black Christ. Here we go. God's glory and my country's shame, and how one man who cursed Christ's name may never fully expiate that crime till at the blessed gate of heaven he meet and pardon me out of his love and charity. How God, who needs no man's applause, for love of my stark soul of flaws, composed, seeing it slip, did stoop down to the mirror and pick me up, and in the hollow of his hand enact again at my command the world's supremest tragedy, until I die my burthen be. How Calvary in Palestine, extending down to me and mine, was but the first leaf in a line of trees on which a man should swing. World without end in suffering, for all men's healing, let me sing. So what you'll find during this time, a lot of Christians used the parallel of Christ and the struggle of black people. You can see it here in poetry. It exists also in music, with a lot of gospel music. And this was probably the single most strongest element for most black Americans who were Christian, that their faith really gave them the strength to continue on in the face of adversity, and also as they climbed out of oppression, that their faith was there, that they'd seen what had happened to Christ, and that they could use that as a way to be inspired to also move on out of an oppressive situation. So now you see, now you have three different poets with three different approaches. You have Langston Hughes, who's more like someone who spoke right to the people, very folk style, specifically black folk. Then you had Claude McKay. He's more of a revolutionary type who was ready to do whatever he had to do to get out of oppression. And then you have Countee Cullen, who is a more spiritual approach and who's coming from a place of faith. And so that's three totally different approaches. But at the same time, the goal was to be free. So they just had three different ways to travel down the road to eventually get to the land of freedom, whether that be a physical place or a place of their mind, body, and soul, or mind and soul. Next, we're going to move on to James Weldon Johnson. James Weldon Johnson was born on June 17th, 1871 in Jacksonville, Florida. Now we'll go on to the next photo. And we have a list of different things that represent James Weldon Johnson. Here we go right here. He was an author, a politician, a diplomat, a critic, a journalist, a poet, an anthologist, a professor, a lawyer, a songwriter, an early civil rights activist, and prominent figure in the Harlem Renaissance. He's best remembered for his writing, which includes novels, poems, and collections of folklore. So this is like a really, really accomplished man. He graduated from Atlanta University, and that was in 1894. In 1901, he writes Lift Every Voice and Sing. We'll talk about that a little later. 1904, he joins Theodore Roosevelt's presidential campaign. And then in 1906 through 1908, he served as the United States Consul to Venezuela. From 1909 to 1913, he served as the United States Consul to Nicaragua. And then you can see there, right after that, he writes his autobiography anonymously. And while serving in the NAACP from 1914 to 1930, Johnson started as an organizer and eventually became the first black male secretary in the organization's history. And then in 1927, he asserts authorship of autobiography, making it a Renaissance text. So he wrote as an anonymous author his own autobiography. So this is a pretty accomplished man right here, both in the areas of arts and politics. Outstanding people, outstanding thinkers. They didn't have smartphones. So they had to get up and do things with their time in a different kind of way. You can just see this whole list of different things that he represents. That's extremely impressive. An author, politician, diplomat, critic, journalist, poet, anthologist, professor, lawyer, songwriter, early civil rights activist. You know, that's a lot of accomplishment. And something to really check out. They really, you know, one of the reasons why they were so accomplished is because they didn't have access to a lot of things. So they really had to prove themselves to society. And because they were really trying to free black people from oppression. But these were very, very intelligent thinkers and doers. That's the difference. They were thinkers and doers. Now, let's move on to Lift Every Voice and Sing, which I read on the list. So Lift Every Voice and Sing is a poem. It originally was a poem that James Weldon Johnson wrote. Now, his brother was J. Rosamond Johnson. He was a composer and a musician. He wrote music, and he and his brother put the music and the poem together to create what we now know as the Negro National Anthem, or the Black National Anthem. That's known among black people. This is a song that represents a lot to black people in terms of freedom and blackness during that time, and it has endured over time and still is that song that represents a lot of black people's feelings and hope and spiritual and also and in country and everything like that. But this is the man who wrote it right here. And I think it's amazing that he was all of those things, plus he wrote a poem that became the Black National Anthem. I mean, that's pretty amazing because his list is so long. Not to say that anybody who just wrote lyrics is any less than him, but to say that, you know, this guy was, you know, a politician, a diplomat, you know, takes a break from one of those things. At the time, actually, I'll tell you, at the time he was working at a school, and he was an educator at that time when he wrote this. But in all, you know, all in all, that's pretty amazing that he went in so many different directions and was so intelligent and accomplished in every direction. So that's pretty amazing. Now we're going to listen to a recent recording. This is something that just happened the past, you know, maybe 20, 30 years, this recording. It's not an original recording from back in the days when it was conceived, but you're going to hear a new version of the Negro National Anthem. So let's listen. You probably heard it before, but let's listen. Here we go. That was the Black or the Negro National Anthem by James Weldon Johnson. So it's a very positive spiritual. You can hear the tones, you can hear the melody. It's very joyous but calm at the same time. It's not a shout, right? It's not a shout, you know. Praise and worship, kind of, you know, high energy. It's not that. It's very calm, and it's a very spiritual poem that he wrote. And actually, you know what? I'm going to do something just right off the cuff, or I'm going to improvise, okay? So let's actually hear the lyrics real quick. I'm gonna read them to you just in case you couldn't hear them in the song. So lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise. High as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present, the now, has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn had died. He's talking about slavery right there. Yet with a steady beat, have not our weary feet come to the place for which our fathers sighed. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out from the gloomy past, here now we stand at last, where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, though who has brought us thus far on the way, thou who has by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray, lest our feet stray from the places, our God, where we meet thee, lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand, true to our God, true to our native land. So the native land is America. So you get to hear where he's coming from a little better when I just read the lyrics. But you can see that he's talking about spirituality. He's talking about oppression. He's talking about freedom. All these different things in this Negro national anthem. So now you can see, or you know why, it has been chosen to be the Negro national anthem. The words of inspiration are there, and the story is there as well. And the melody with the chords is very nice and uplifting. So that I wanted to read that to you so you really gained an understanding of what that song was about. So now I'm going to close out the class with Langston Hughes speaking at UCLA. And this was in 1967. This was the year that he passed away, actually. So we wrap around back to the top to Langston Hughes. And just listen to him speak. He's going to talk about his writings and his approaches and his views on different writers as well. So just listen and enjoy it, and we'll see you at session 8. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
I play it cool and dig all jive. That's the reason I stay alive. My motto, as I live and learn, is dig and be dug in return. Well, I read you that poem because although it was written in the bebop era, about 15 or more years ago, it is seemingly on the way to becoming one of my most popular poems among the retarded readers. It is a poem that's being used increasingly in the big city schools and in anthologies. And another poem of mine, which was written a long time ago, really, when I lived in San Francisco, and at one time had the title San Francisco, but I later made it a little broader in terminology and call it City now, is also finding its way into a great many anthologies for youngsters who never learned to read very well. And it goes like this. In the morning, the city spreads its wings, making a song in stone that sings. In the evening, the city goes to bed, hanging lights about its head. Well, if that poem increasingly is used in anthologies, I think I can make my living off of it for a year or two, because each one pays a nice little fee, you see, and they write me a nice little note and say it's just ideally suited for children who, you know, who are a little over age and can't quite read well. So you can see from those two examples that my poetry on the whole is very simple, because most of my poems are equally simple, really. And I am delighted that we have among the younger Negro poets a number of poets who write very avant-garde, very complicated, and poets whom I myself, try as I do, cannot quite understand. And I asked one of them the other day why they put, you know, one word way over on this side and then two words here, another word way on that side of the page, and then jump down about six spaces and put another one with some dots. And I didn't get a very adequate explanation, except that it was a way of keeping the reader's eye moving about the page. Well, I must say that some of those of our younger poets, however, are very talented indeed, and I hope that you will watch out particularly for a young man named David Henderson, who is in some of the avant-garde anthologies, and a young lady named Alice Walker, who's a sharecropper's daughter from Georgia by way of Spelman College, and now has a fellowship to McDowell Colony, where she's working on a novel. 21 years old, a very talented girl, both in prose and poetry. So I just throw out those two names for you in case they haven't reached the coast yet. And then, of course, somewhat older, but young too, and very talented, is a name that I'm sure you've heard out here, Leroy Jones. I hope you know Leroy's poetry, because Leroy is a very talented young man, inclined, you know, to, well, to work on the shock side. And I'm sure he couldn't be published in Bruin, because I understand Bruin was really suppressed for using a few mild bad words. However, he's a very talented young man. His plays particularly are brilliant, and they're about to release Dutchman in the movies. And I, as an older writer and an older poet and a more conservative one, at least as far as verbiage goes, words go, I'm glad that we have in the Negro race poets like Leroy, because there are a lot of poets like Leroy in the white race, you know, including Allen Ginsberg, whom I just read today was censored out somewhere at some college where he was supposed to speak tonight. I don't know if you've had Leroy here. If you haven't, try and bring him and see what happens, you know. What I was about to say, however, is that I'm glad that we in the Negro race have young people who are doing everything that everybody else does. I think we as American Negroes should do everything everybody else does, and usually when we do something, we often do it better, you know? We do it we do it even more far out. So we have some avant-garde poets right now who are more avant-garde than the avant.